the contagion soon assumed a most terrible aspect. All the physicians died successively. The overseers of the infirmaries went away, and it was no longer possible to enter the hospitals with impunity. We were obliged to take Turks to nurse the sick and to pay a very great price for their services, while the superintendence over them was so relaxed on account of the danger with which it was accompanied that the most flagrant misconduct was not to be prevented. At General Marmont's lodging, we had been obliged to do without tablecloths or sheets. All our clothes were fumigated. The outdoor servants had no connection with those of the interior. The carriage gateway was nailed up, while everything that was brought to the house from out of doors and even the meat was thrown through a wicket into a tub of water. With a view to avoid the infection among us, we divided ourselves into two brigades, and during the night we pursued each other from room to room, throwing water in our faces, which was the only ammunition we possessed. Among the few soldiers who consented to nurse the sick, there was a gunner who had been in Constantinople, where he pretended that he had escaped the plague. According to his assertion, he possessed an infallible preservative against the infection, which was to keep his face and hands perpetually moistened with water. But it was discovered that he washed his hands in oil. Indeed, it had been observed in Cairo that the lamplighters never caught the plague. After remaining 6 weeks in the unfortunate city of Alexandria, I received from the general in chief an order to return to Cairo that I might accompany him in his campaign to Syria. The Arabs of the province of Damanhour, being well acquainted with the situation of our troops at Alexandria, took advantage of it to renew their depredations. I set off with an escort of 30 men and two small cannons we had taken at Malta, and which General Marmont was kind enough to entrust to me to increase my slender means of defense. But I was obliged, according to custom, to take under my protection a numerous caravan of peasants, women, and children, who profited by my departure to run to Damanhour and Ramania. We had scarcely advanced 2 leagues when the Arabs began to hover about our flanks. The French infantry, which a few months before had not even courage enough to fly before the Arabs, so soon accustomed themselves to dare them that I had the greatest trouble to prevent them from strolling about the plain for the purpose of firing at these enemies. 2 or 3 Arabs were dismounted, and then, to put them completely to the rout, I had only to fire my 2 cannons at them. On my arrival in Cairo, the general-in-chief had already gone off. He had left the place 2 days before, leaving me in order to traverse the city in all directions with the police aga to know whether all was quiet. The aga was at that time a Greek called Barthélemy. He was accompanied by his guards, the executioner, and his servants. We walked with a solemn pace, and at the sight of the aga, all the peddlers in the streets and those whose conscience was not quite clear immediately disappeared. In the Rue du Petit Zouar, he stopped facing a coffee house, and his stick bearer, who walked before him, dragged along by force a man to whom he addressed some questions. The poor fellow answered in great confusion. After reflecting for a moment, the caddy slowly made a horizontal motion with his right hand, and we gravely continued our walk. The gesture of the caddy appeared singular to me. When we had got 30 steps farther, I turned round, and seeing a group of persons assembled before the coffee house, I spurred my horse and perceived with horror a mutilated corpse and the executioner calmly putting a human head into his bag. "What's the meaning of this?" said I to the caddy. "Oh," he answered coolly, "that fellow had a share in the rebellion of Cairo and escaped my vengeance." I insisted on his putting the whole affair regularly down in writing to be communicated to the general in chief. In all probability, the unfortunate man was guilty, but I am convinced that my presence and the wish to give an example of severe justice were the real causes of his death. For the rest, executions of this sort were not rare. The caddy never went out, but accompanied by the hangman. The smallest infraction of the police laws was punished by blows on the soles of the feet, a punishment from which the women themselves were not exempted. Before we enter Syria, I think it will be well to give an account of the general's motives for that expedition. It was absolutely necessary to ensure the conquest of Egypt by that of Syria, and especially by the possession of the maritime places. The two countries are dependent on each other, as well in regard to natural productions as political connection. Egypt has no wood, and a part of Syria is covered with forests. The mutual exchanges extend even to many other productions. The desert alone separates the two countries, and the necessity of establishing one or two forts at the entrance to the desert is indispensable for the possession of Egypt. To these general considerations, at all times equally in force, must be added some particular circumstances which had just been created by policy. In declaring war against France, the Sultan would launch out against us the whole armed population of Syria. The Pasha, who commanded in that province, had a personal interest in showing himself our foe. He would effect his reconciliation with the Porte by the services he might render her. He would draw a great deal of money out of the English and find war the means of subduing or at least removing Ibrahim Bey, whose presence in Syria was disagreeable to him and caused him even some anxiety. On the other hand, General Bonaparte wished to deprive the English of means of communicating with and disembarking on an extent of coast 80 leagues in length. His intention was to make himself master of the maritime places and fortify them. He had hopes of drawing over his party a considerable portion of the inhabitants of Syria, especially the Druzes and the Maronists, schismatic Muslims, whose manner are at variance with those of the Turks and who have no other connection with them but through the enormous taxes they are forced to pay, and the multifarious oppression under which they labor. Finally, he expected by that means to force the Porte to explain herself openly, for he was not yet acquainted with the declaration of war made by the Turks against France. He placed at the head of the expedition General Reynier as commander of the vanguard, and Generals Kleber, Bon, and Lannes, and Murat for the cavalry. He left in Egypt General Desaix vigorously pursuing Murad Bey and keeping in awe all the provinces of the Upper Nile as far as the cataracts. General Dugua in Cairo commanded the delta from the Rosetta and the Damietta. He had under his orders General Lanuza, whose courage and activity were sufficient to maintain peace in all those extensive provinces. The season was favorable for the expedition to Syria, which began in January 1799. The desert which divides Egypt from Syria is 80 leagues in breadth, and that space of land are found the wells of Katish, which were enclosed in a fort that the army might not be without water. At 2 days' march beyond, the well is the fort of El Arish, which contains better water than Katish, but of which the enemy had already made himself master. We were forced to besiege it, and it was bravely defended by 2,000 Arnauts. They were, however, constrained to capitulate after a vigorous attack of 3 days. In the treaty, it was stipulated that they should go to Damascus, but the greater number among them threw themselves into Jaffa, of which place they augmented the garrison. We were obliged, in consequence, to besiege the town. Jaffa was taken by storm a few days after the first attack, and the Arnauts, who had capitulated at El Arish, being found within its walls, were, according to the European custom, shot for having violated the treaty. I was not at that time with the general-in-chief, having joined him only the day after the taking of Jaffa. From Jaffa, the army marched to Kaifa. But the enemy had abandoned that place, though it possessed a fort and strong walls. We left there a small post and continued our way to St. John of Acre, near which city we arrived on the evening of the 27th of March. While the tents were being pitched, the general-in-chief was surprised to hear at sea a tolerably brisk cannonading. I went by his orders to the shore and soon perceived that the sound was becoming more distant, so that I feared it might be the announcement of some fatal event. on entering Syria, General Bonaparte had given orders to Marmont to send him some brig, the ammunition he should want for the sieges of the Syrian towns. Captain Stanley, who commanded the frigate, which was at the head of the expedition, neglected to inquire whether we were masters of Jaffa, on the walls of which place we had left the Turkish flag flying, to draw in the enemy's ships, which might bring us provisions and news from sea. Stanley, persuaded we were not at Jaffa, went in to St. John of Acre, but Commodore Sir Sidney Smith, who was cruising before the port with a ship and a frigate, gave him the chase and took a part of his vessels. This was the cause of the cannonading we heard, and General Bonaparte was convinced, as well as myself, that the army had lost all its siege ammunition. The next day, the army encamped to the north of St. John of Acre, and the general-in-chief stood during several hours on a height that commands St. John of Acre at about half a league distant. The enemy, perceiving the staff, made trial of the skill of their gunners. The bombs fired with so much nicety that one of them was buried in the ground 3 paces from the general between his 2 aides-de-camp, Merlin and Beauharnais. Another fell and burst at 2 feet from the soil in the midst of a group of soldiers who were lying down preparing their breakfast. There were 11 of them, and not one survived an instant. The town of St. John of Acre is situated on the point of a narrow strip of land fortified toward the sea by batteries, at a small lighthouse, and also protected by some pieces of cannon. On the land side, it was enclosed by a high wall, divided by a tower on which some pieces of ordnance had been placed. The city was surrounded at a considerable distance by gardens, which being all enclosed with the hedges of cactus, we had much trouble in repelling the riflemen who harassed us from behind them. The traveler Volney, whom we had found so accurate in his description of Egypt, asserts that St. John of Acre is not surrounded with ditches. This assurance proved fatal to us in the beginning of the siege. Several officers of the engineers confirmed us in our prepossession, and particularly Colonel Sampson, who was wounded in his hand while fighting in a muddy rivulet he supposed to have been the fosse of the town. After we had fired 10 days on the tower I have mentioned, it was pierced, and the breach appeared large enough to lodge some miners with an officer of the staff. The troop made a movement to rush to the foot of the town, but they were suddenly stopped by a ditch 15 feet broad by 10 or 12 deep and lined with a good counterscarp. We were, in consequence, forced to establish a globe of compression to blow it up. The concussion took place, and young Maillet Chateau-Renaud, an officer of the staff, received orders to enter the tower with the 4 miners to remain there during the night and to pierce it, while the infantry endeavored to make themselves masters of the ditch. The intrepid officer and his men executed their orders, but the enemy opened so strong a fire on our troops that they were forced to abandon the fosse. Maillet and his gunners were killed in the breach. The aide-de-camp, Duroc, had been sent an hour before into the ditch to discover the progress of the breach. A howitzer that burst wounded him deeply in the thigh and lamed him. The night falling in, we were constrained to give up the attack and to wait until the arrival of a larger supply of artillery should furnish us with the means of making breaches on all sides. But just at that moment, the general-in-chief heard that all his ammunition, all his artillery sent from Alexandria, had been captured by Sir Sidney Smith, while at the same time we learned the secret cause of the astonishing skill of the Turkish gunners. When a few years before the period I am speaking of, General Albert Duvalier was sent by the French government to Constantinople as ambassador, he obtained leave to take with him a company of light artillery to teach the Turks those parts of gunnery they were still unacquainted with, and especially all that concerned the letting off of bombs. This company had since returned to France, and part of them were in besieging the army, but their pupils were in the fortress, so that the Turkish bombardiers, instructed by French troops, were sending us our own projectiles, of which they possessed about 1,800 with 4 mortars. The trenches had not been regularly made, and the consequence of that neglect was that the soldiers not being sufficiently covered fell victims to our precipitation. General Caffarelli, commander of the engineers of the army, was struck himself by a bullet on his left elbow, and he lost his arm. He had already suffered the loss of a leg several years before during the retreat of Jourdain. The Turks are wonderfully good soldiers behind a wall. We had more than one instance of that during the whole siege of St. John of Acre. It was almost impossible for a Frenchman to show himself uncovered without being struck. The terrible fire of the besieged was supported by the batteries of Sir Sidney's ship Theseus and his frigate. The labors of the siege soon grew more complicated. Sir Sidney Smith had with him a Frenchman named Philippot, an emigrant, formerly a schoolfellow of General Bonaparte and an officer of engineers. He raised two redoubts beyond the fosse, the batteries of which soon ranged along the branches of our trenches and forced us to begin new works to change their direction. The field pieces being 2 weeks to destroy the tower, we had recourse to mining. But while we were working with great activity and secrecy, we continued firing on the town. More than once we entertained the hope of gaining a footing in it and destroying it. But it was in vain that our grenadiers and sappers endeavored several times to take possession of it. The part that looked toward the town continued to be occupied by the besieged, who never ceased throwing on our troops howitzers, grenades, and even bombs, which made the post exceedingly dangerous. Notwithstanding all our efforts, the two redoubts constructed by the enemy covered us with their fire every time our troops crossed the ditch to storm the tower. The officer of engineers, Philippot, soon guessed we were making mines and applied himself to destroy those we were laying under the ditch. In consequence, on the 18th Germinal, the enemy made a sortie with so much abruptness and violence that a part of our trenches was destroyed. The enemy's columns were commanded by intelligent English officers, one of whom reached the entrance of the mine where he was killed. The papers on him informed us that he was Captain Hatfield and that he had been the first at the attack of the Cape of Good Hope. His fall caused some confusion among the troops he commanded, who soon after being attacked with energy, hastily returned to the city, leaving a great many killed behind him. While we were fighting under the walls of St. John of Acre, like the Crusaders beyond the Jordan, Ibrahim Bey, the bearer of the orders of the Djezzar Pasha, assembled all the Arabs in the mountains of Nablus and even the environs of Damascus. The general chief had taken the precautions to make himself master of the bridge of Jakub and the port of Jaffet. The banks of the lake of Tabaria were constantly overrun by the cavalry of General Murat. General Junot had posted himself at Luby near Nazareth. He was soon attacked at a short distance from Garfakala, and though he had only with him a part of the 2nd Regiment of Light Infantry, three companies of the 19th, and 150 dragoons, he did not hesitate to dare the charge of above 3,000 horsemen. Notwithstanding all the efforts of the enemy, he succeeded in reaching the heights of Nazareth without having been routed. And after 8 hours of the most desperate fighting, he forced the enemy to a temporary retreat. This glorious defense made the general-in-chief feel the necessity of terminating once for all the annoyance of these dangerous enemies, whose plan was no less than to come and attack him under the walls of St. John of Acre. He sent General Kleber against them, and a few days afterwards, he marched himself to the support of Junot and Kleber with the rest of his cavalry, the division of the General Bon, and 8 pieces of artillery. He directed his way towards Fouilly. At 9 o'clock in the morning, he had reached the last heights, whence the prospect extends 3 leagues over the plain bounded by Mount Thabor. From thence, we perceived the square of General Kleber, presenting a black line surrounded and pressed by an enormous mass of cavalry and infantry, which at 3 leagues' distance had all the appearance of an anthill. Sometimes the French line disappeared and we thought it destroyed. Then it showed itself again, covered by its own fire. During some minutes, the general chief began by throwing his cavalry on the heights to his right, where the camp of the Mamelukes had been established, and which we found deserted. He thus formed two squares of infantry and made his arrangements so as to turn the enemy at a great distance. When he arrived at within half a league of General Kleber, he sent to him General Rampont at the head of the 32nd Half Brigade. And as soon as that troop had begun the march, he made known his presence by firing a 12-pounder. The effect was theatrical. At the same instant, we saw General Kleber quitting his defensive attitude, advancing upon the village of Fouilly, of which he made himself master, and the enemy flying in all directions. But on the one side of the enemy found before him General Rampont, while General Vial had cut off his retreat to the mountains of Naplus, and General Murat was waiting for him at the bridge of Jacoup. The guides on foot attacked him near Jenin, so that his only resource was to fly behind Mount Thabor, from whence during the night he reached El Makania, and further up the Jordan, where a great number were drowned in attempting to cross the river.